first for my own personal projects, for instruction. You know, I like to eat. So that's what I'm into now. And you know, I really got into primitive traps and stuff about 10 or 12 years ago, and that's really held my interest. So, well, what I always start with in trapping is tracking. Tracking is 90% of trapping. You can have the best whiz-bang trap in the world, but if it's in a crater in the moon, it ain't going to catch it. We got to put it in the right spot. So what the first couple things we got to look at is two different types of tracking. First, we have landscape trapping, or tracking, and that is being able to have an understanding to be able to stand here and look at this landscape and automatically narrow down the spots we're going to go look at for sign tracking, which is actual signs of animals. And to explain that a little bit, if I'm standing here looking at this area, we're looking at this hillside, okay? If we look at this big rocky outcropping, that's not the place to set traps. No animal's going to go up there because they are lazy. They're going to take the easiest method. We're going to want to look at things like this row of trees coming down, these cuts. Any kind of obstacle, most animals will go around, and that will give you the place to trap. Animals have three or four major places they hang out in. Bedding areas, which is where they live and sleep. Feeding areas, that will depend on the type of animal. You know, it could be these oak trees, it could be some grass for some deer, whatever. Then we have watering areas. Every animal comes to the water. Feeding areas are going to be different for different animals. And then in between that places is all going to be travel routes. That's where we're going to trap. So we need to learn to identify the travel routes. And to explain why we're going to trap on travel routes. Feeding. All right, so what we're going to learn to identify is the travel routes and why we want to trap them travel routes. Is think about yourself in your bedding area. You have a bedding area, it's your house. If I came into your house and set a trap in the center of your living room, you're going to automatically notice that something's different, right? Okay, if you watch the way animals feed in a feeding area, they will come in, take a bite, look while they're chewing, they're on their game, they're looking. Same way with watering holes. When these animals are traveling in these areas, they're moving. So they're paying attention to moving. They're a little bit less on their game. And to me, that is the place to catch them. Because they're better at this than you are. The easiest thing to outsmart in trapping is yourself. People overthink this stuff. And what I realized doing some trapping classes with people is I do a lot of teaching people how to build traps. I don't teach them how to trap. So I've kind of rearranged my stuff and geared it more towards learning how to trap, not exactly how to build traps. You can learn that in a book, in the internet. I mean, there's a bunch of guys here that sell, I mean, way better at this than me, that sell books that you can look at, take it to the field with you. All right, so we're going to look more at how to trap, not how to build traps. But we are going to build some traps because, I mean, that's what we're here for, right? It's dirt time. So, after we look at some landscape trapping, we can narrow down here. Let's see these ground squirrels, right? If you know ground squirrels, you look around here, you see all these little holes out in the flat spots, right? Ground squirrels, that's the place to trap them. If we look back here, there's a lot of grass and water. I found tons of deer back here in the past 2 days. So when we learn, and it takes nothing but experience. I say nothing but experience. That's the hard gained experience, and it's up to nobody but you. I can't teach you that. You got to go learn it yourself by looking, observing, being there. And there'll be a guy tomorrow giving a tracking class, so I'm kind of dancing around the tracking because I want you guys to learn from, you know, an actual tracking class from a professional tracker. And like I said, 90% of this class is going to be his class. if that makes sense to you. Okay, 10% is building traps. I mean, any monkey can do that. I can do it. So, after we learn to narrow down these areas of where we're going to look, we need to start looking for specific animal sign till we identify the animals that are there. If we can identify what they're feeding on, that'll give us a clue on how to bait the trap, right? What we're going to look for is actual seeing the animal, tracks, scat, refuse. Refuse is like chewed up nuts, that kind of thing, like you see chewed up acorns left from squirrels, stuff like that. Remains, which could be the actual remains of the animals that live there, or the remains of an animal that was eaten by another, and that will give you a clue to that. So we get into this tracking class tomorrow. I'm sure he's going to cover all this stuff in detail, so I don't want to confuse a lot of this. You'd say, well, Steve said this and he says this, so you know, we're going to do it that way. In learning to trap, I kind of set my mindset to the same way I teach how to use a bow drill. I use a proven bow drill set to teach how to start a bow drill fire. That way you know if it's not working, it's you and not the set, right? Because if you don't know it's unproven set, you don't know if it's the set or you. So if we can use, to start out trapping, a trap that we know that's going to work, right, which will be either a simple, very, very simple primitive trap or a man-made modern steel trap. And this will help you even at your house. Learning to trap at your house would be the best thing in the world, because you can look around your yard and stuff like this and find out where the mice are running and learn to identify them runs. And then, you know, use a mouse trap and trap mice in your kitchen. I mean, you can practice trapping anywhere. It's the same game no matter where it's at. So what I want to talk a little bit about here some modern traps. I'm sure everybody's seen a trap that looks like this, right? This is a leg hold trap. This is the number one single spring leg hold trap. Every one of these traps is made on the same principle. There's a frame, a spring of some sort. This is a long spring because it's got a long spring. They also make these with double coil springs. It has a jaw, a pan, which is this part, which gets stepped on, that's the pan. This is called the dog. Why it's called the dog, I have absolutely no idea. Then you have a notch in your trigger. And usually these all have a chain. A lot of them have a swivel in it and some way to attach it to the ground. This one actually has a slider on it, and we'll get into that in a little bit. First thing with any kind of modern steel traps, this little trap looks pretty small and it's pretty easy to squeeze that spring down. This will break your fingers. Going to have to learn to respect this, and there's a really easy way to do it, to set these traps up. And I'll show you how to do it, which I guarantee you if you do it the way I show you, you will never get your fingers in it. With that said, I'll tell you a real quick story about steel traps. I was about, I don't know, 10 or 12. I was using number 2 double coil spring traps that were modified with an extra set of springs. That trap's about this big around. At 12 years old, you can see how big I am now, right? At 12 years old, I was about 80 pounds soaking wet. So I could not break them springs over on my knee with my hands. And I had to put it on the ground and step on it and set that trap. So I was at my grandparents. They owned a great big stretch of the Stillwater River bottom. And I was trapping. It was cold. I mean, really cold. These are real hard to operate with gloves on, right? So I take my gloves off, throw the trap down on the ground, throw this down, I'm setting it, everything slips. Steve is now like this with his fingers in a number 2 modified, you know, trap. It's a mile and a half to my grandmother's house. So here's the story. I walked a mile and a half with my hands in the trap like this. A very, very strong trap. House. My grandma's 90 years old. You think she can get that trap off my fingers?
Probably.
No. No. Right, so here I am. My thumbs are blue. I'm freezing cold. I got my hands in the trap all because I didn't set it right. Now, if I'm out by myself farther away than being able to run across the cornfield to grandma's house, we could have big problems, especially if it's a stake to the ground. Because now how am I going to pull that stake out, right? So safety is paramount with any of these traps. They can really, really hurt you. And with these leg hold traps, there's just a real easy trick to it. You don't stick your fingers in the jaw. That should make sense. How did I get my thumbs out? My grandmother called my dad. I lived about a mile down the road from my grandma's house. My dad come down, and when he got done laughing at me, he got my fingers out of the trap. I couldn't use my thumbs for a couple days. I mean, they were busted up. So just keep that in mind. Anytime you mess with a steel trap, think old Steve with his thumb stuck in it, okay?
Did it actually break the bone in your thumb?
No, it just bruised me up pretty bad. It wasn't like a full, you know, it was. So anyways, set these steel traps the safe way. On these, you have two jaws, right? One is the dead jaw, and one is the live jaw. The live jaw is the dangerous one. It will be on the side that your dog is on, okay? That's the jaw that will get trapped by this dog. So what I want to do is face this away from me. Make sure my dog's out. I'm going to squeeze this down like this. Now if you notice, the dead jaw here, my thumb is under. So if I comes out, I didn't get my finger. Okay? That's the most important thing to remember on these. I want to cover a little bit of safety before we get to setting these and stuff, just so when I hand these around, we don't have to laugh at that people with their fingers stuck in there. Of course, because I will laugh, just to let you know. Alright, so I got my thumb under that pan. You see that? And I'm pressing the dog into the notch. Now I cannot push that down. I can shake it around, it's not going to go off. I got it trapped. Alright? Now if you'll look the way this sits. Everybody see that pan's all cocked up? My jaws are kind of laying funny. That's because on these long spring traps, you need to hold onto the frame with your thumb under the pan and turn this jaw or this spring just a little bit towards the live side, and that jaw will drop like that, and then we're going to set our pan level. And this pan sits pretty level. That's pretty important. Now if this doesn't sit like that, and when you buy a new trap, it will not. New traps, you can't just take them out of the box and use them. Okay, you got to tune them. What that will involve is adjusting the length of this dog to catch that notch in the right manner. And it's really kind of an art form. It's not really, you kind of got to do it a couple times to understand exactly what you got to do. But you end up filing a little bit just so that'll set level. This is a number one. This is like the smallest leg hold I own. This is good for like a muskrat or a mink. I didn't bring any big traps because I had to fly here and I didn't want to bring a bunch of stuff on the airplane. So, you know, this I brought some small stuff. This would be great all around small game trap, like rabbits and squirrels and such. So, that is a tuned number one leg hold. This is the most versatile, multi-versatile, I should say, multi-versatile steel trap made, in my opinion. Anything I talk about trapping is in my opinion. It's not. Everybody's got their own way to do it, okay? This is a conibear. This is a killing type trap. This will also break your fingers, okay? So let's keep that in mind. And the way these work is this is two wire squares that turn inside out from each other, basically, when this goes off. And it's the same way. It has a frame, but the frame is also the jaws. It has a spring and a triggering system, and this triggering system is really simple. Okay? Basically, how these operate is you squeeze that jaw down. And then you break this over. The way to be safe with these is to hold it with your palm and your tips of your fingers on the sides. So if it gets away from you, it comes out of your hand. If you got it by one jaw, you're going to whistle Dixie for sure, I promise you. I've been there too. Now this is the smallest conibear they make that I know of. These come in a lot of different sizes. This is a 110. A 220 is 7.5 inches by 8.25 or something like that. They have 330s, and the bigger ones you get, they start having springs on them. A 330 requires a tool to set it. That's how strong they are. They use them for beavers and stuff like that. The way these operate here, okay, we're gonna have this set. The spring collapse. You'll see this has a little notch in it that exposes the wire frame. The dog on this one has a series of notches in it. Okay? What that does is engages that wire and just sits on it. Like this. And when we set that there, all that does is sit on there until we let some tension on it and it catches. The way that trigger fires is this frame bumps that off. You guys see that?
Mm-hmm.
It just lifts that up. So what we want to do is hold on to this, set it on a notch, and let go. Okay? That's set.
What are the different notches for?
We'll get to that.
That'd be fine.
Alright. So, the way this operates, right? Well, this is going to be scary because you're trying to hold this up. Alright? Is these two squares will swing around and hopefully break the neck or choke out whatever you're catching. Like that.
Oh my God.
Okay? I mean, this is the real deal. I mean, and we're going to get into some setup with these different traps. And, a leg hold. Okay, so this is a conibear or a body. A conibear is actually a brand name. This is a body grip. Style of trap. All kinds of brands make them, you know, Duke and Victor and a little bit of everybody. I've never actually seen an actual conibear brand. Conibear.
Well, conibear is the guy that invented that.
Is it? Okay, but they do actually have a conibear brand.
Right.
Conibear. I've never seen
one. Backed up what he was just saying. My father used these traps. They're the best.
Another type of trap. Here is my most used trap. Anybody that knows me, knows Dude, knows this is the deal right here. You can get two of these at Lowe's for $3.98. Right? I paint mine green just because I'm kind of tactical like that. I drill a hole in it, put a piece of paracord on it. Everybody knows how a rat trap sets. Or a mouse trap. A rat trap is a whole nother monster from a mouse trap, okay?
Yep.
You can get your fingers in there. The way I do it,
how do you set that one up safely?
Here's how you set this up safely, alright?
Getting it to somebody else.
You're going to aim this triggering piece away from you, just like everything else. Up here where your fingers can get smacked. If this goes off, it'll just exactly what happened right now. It'll go off and look at my fingers. You get that second notch and let some tension on it, okay? And all I do is put a little peanut butter on there or whatever I got for bait and set this down. And then I always tie this to something. This is not to hold the animal there. It's to keep something from stealing your catch. I've had that happen. I've come up on my traps and had red tails in them. Not in the trap, but stealing my dinner. Coons in them, house cats. House cats are another good reason for conibears, and we'll get into that later. All right, just for people, I'm sorry if you can't see, but I'm not willing to snap my fingers in this thing.
Wow.
The difference in power in a rat trap and a mouse trap is that. You see, it put two pretty good grooves in a stick, a dry stick. So it's no joke to mess around with, right? But very, very, very effective. And why I like these modern steel traps, again, is when we're learning the trap, we can take the trap out of the equation because we know the trap's right. So if we're failing with a modern factory-built trap, we know it's us and not the trap set, right? Does that make sense? I was hoping it made sense, but I ain't tried this out on nobody yet. And there's a lot of real simple ways to use these traps, but with these steel traps, I'll get into a little bit more on some things that I do to traps. Factory trap, if it's not modded, it's not mine, right? This one is not modded, but it's my, well, yeah, it is. I put a swivel in there, okay? And the bigger traps, depending on what you're going after, like people that trap coyotes and wolves and different things like that, they will beef these traps up. They'll do things like laminate another piece of steel on the frame, or you'll take a groove out of the jaw. And what that'll do, you'll notice my finger, okay, in this, about representative of something's leg. The way this holds is the way this spring slides up on that jaw, right? If we take a little more of a groove out of there, this can come closer together and that spring can come up and it'll hold a little better. Another very popular thing to do is to put a swivel in the chain. What that'll do is when you get something lively, he's not real happy about having his foot in here, and he's going to flop and do all this, and you'd be surprised at how small of an animal can break a steel chain if you give them long enough time to try it. They'll just twist it up and beat it up. But this trap is not as versatile to me as a conibear, but they're very useful for certain things. And we'll get into it here in a minute when we get into how to use some of these. This trap can also be made into a killing trap. Now, depending on how you think, an animal in a trap with his foot stuck, he's still alive, you have the chance to let him go, okay? If it's something, you know, you catch a skunk and you don't want to eat a skunk, you can let him go. But to me, an animal stuck in a trap for very long a time just seems kind of mean, right? So I can make this kill, and I'll show you how. Okay, it's usually used in water trapping fur bears, like mink, coons, muskrats, beavers, that type of thing. But, you know, if you use this around a water's edge, you can use it to kill just about anything. So let's get into a couple of quick trap sets. It's going to be hard for people to see back here.
Get on the table.
Well, I got to set them in the dirt.
Set it on the table?
If there's dirt on the table, you know, I gotta make it.
Okay.
People back here, if you can't see real good, I apologize, because we're gonna set traps in the dirt. Okay? So if you want to rearrange yourself a little bit, it might help your cause a little bit. I can't fake dirt like up on a table where you can see it. So we've done our landscape tracking. We've narrowed it down with sign tracking. Now we know where we're going to set our trap. Let's look at a simple way to set this unbaited blind. Unbaited is called a blind set in the trapping world. On, let's say, one of these little squirrel trails. Let's use our imagination. And this is a squirrel run. You can see them two lines in the dirt. We got to use our imagination. You get cool points if you know where imagination's coming from. Anybody?
SpongeBob,
right. See, he wins. All right, we got us a trail, a squirrel trail. We know it's well-traveled. We've done our tracking. We found maybe some scats, some tracks, refuse, whatever. We've confirmed this, okay? So we got our trail. What we need to do is bed this trap. So we're going to set this trap, and we're going to set it with the pan up as high as we can get it. That way we have the most dog in the notch. Safe is a relative term, and that's as safe as you can do this, okay? You're going to set this, and you're going to set it in the trail and look at it a second, okay? That ain't going to work. What we need to do is kind of see our outline here, okay? This ground is hard as concrete, so I don't know how good this is going to work. On runs and stuff like that, you know, where stuff's traveling, it works really good for it. Man, a lot of that stuff's hard. Alright, so we're going to kind of half do this here.
Imagination.
Alright, so I'm going to keep this dirt because I need this dirt. Now usually I'd have a sifter, which is just a wooden frame with a piece of hardware cloth in it, okay? Sift dirt, because we don't want any of this stuff. These little rocks. What I'm going to do now, I'm going to line my trap up the way I want it. I'm going to make sure it sits in that hole. Now when you set it in this hole, the bottom of your frame contacting the ground is very, very, very important. Okay, animals are very pressure sensitive. I've had a lot of traps. Mr. Coyote come walking down, he feels that pan give, or that trap rock. He'll step on the edge of that frame, or the jaws, he pulls his foot out. A lot of coyotes are highly educated on traps. I mean, seriously, it only takes once. I've had tons of traps dug out, all kinds of stuff, because I failed. So, we got our hole set. This is setting pretty good, okay? We'll take our chain, and we'll stake our chain down under our trap. I'm not going to bother staking it here, but you get the idea, right? So we're going to have that in the trail. It sits pretty solid. Daggone, who's got a piece of paper I can have? I forgot my parchment paper.
There you go.
Big enough?
Usually I use a cottonwood leaf for this. At my house, cottonwood leaves are this big around. In California, cottonwood leaves are this big around. So, a piece of wax paper works real good for this, okay? I'm going to take and size this up. To about the size of the inside of my frame. I'm going to take, flip my jaw up, okay? Thumb under the pan. I'm going to take this piece of paper and slide it in. The wind would cooperate, I was going to slide this in. Slide that piece of paper in there. Daggone it. Have I ever told you guys about the curse of the wilderness instructor? I can do this a million times by myself and it'll be perfect. When you're all watching me,
camouflage
traps? What's that?
Is that meant to camouflage?
No. The paper is actually, I guess you can consider it part of the camouflage, but not really. So, I got that paper, or a leaf, over that pan, right? I'm going to leave it kind of proud so you can see what's going on here. I'm going to take my dirt in my sifter and sift this back over my trap. Okay? Well, hold on a minute. So, I'm going to kind of half do this here so we can kind of see what's going on. Alright? The way this trap works, right, what happens? Animal steps on that pan, the pan goes down. Releases the dog, trap comes shut. If I bed this trap, fill it full of dirt, where's the pan going to go? Nowhere. Why we're going to sift the dirt is when this trap comes shut. If you got a rock or a stick in there that's bigger around than this animal's leg, he's gone. It ain't going to shut. Okay? So basically, you know, we'll camouflage this up. Yeah. I'll try to do a half job here. And obviously our chain would be under the trap. Okay, we got our trail here, right? How are we going to make that animal step on that pan? The art of trapping is making 100 acres into this. Okay? So what we're going to do is either we're going to fence this off with some sticks or whatever we can do. Animals take the path of least resistance, okay? He's cruising through here. What happened? Stepped right over it, okay? We need to make him step on that pan. How we're going to do that... Don't get ahead of me, Alan.
Oh, no, I'm just...
You're going to have to leave. How we're going to make him step in that, okay? Let's think about how we walk in the woods, right? I'm cruising through the woods. Do I step right on that log? Nope, I step to it and step over it, right? When I'm here, I look for a rattlesnake first. So, I'm going to use what's called a step stick. I'm going to place this there and there. That way I got him coming and going. He's going to come up, step over the stick, bang. He won't come all the way over because the other step stick's there. Same way coming this way. Make sense? Tracking? All right. So Mr. Animal's cruising along. Bam! He got it. That's a way to use a leg hold trap in a blind set. Okay? Let's look at how to use this a couple ways in a baited set. Baited sets are always more productive for me than a blind set.
What was the purpose of the leaf over it?
Just to keep the dirt out from under the pan so the pan can travel down. What happens a lot with this when you're trapping, the day before trapping season.
Grab the bird trap.
The day before, where's Paul at?
Man, I mean, where's Paul? Get that pigeon.
Get the pigeon.
It's been tagged.
Yeah.
Ah, 151.
Almost.
All right, so anyways.
Hey, we have a second hand now.
Well, it's a trapping class, not a catching class.
All right, so that's a way to use it blind, and I use them in sets of opportunity. Like I'm coming along, I see a real heavily used trail, I'll set a blind set just for that extra catch. My bread and butter is baited sets. Depending on your target animal, I usually deal with fur bears, which are mostly meat eaters, except for beavers and muskrats. Excuse me. We're going to set this up in a baited set. Now, you know how to bed a trap, so we're not going to go through all that again. The first one is the easiest set in the world, okay? It's called a dirt hole set. Basically, I'm going to find a good place with some sign of, say, a mink or a coyote. This is the awesomest coyote set in the world because it's fast. Gonna figure out why this is called a dirt hole set right here. I'm gonna burn me a hole in the ground. Just like that. Okay? That's your dirt hole. I'm going to take and bed my trap, just like we bedded it there. In front of it. We're going to use our imaginations and that's bedded, okay? I'm going to shove my bait down in that hole. Now we're back to the problem of making this animal come this way instead of doing what coyotes always do, and they do this. They circle everything. So what we're going to do is just back this a little bit. It's just called a backing. So now Mr. Animal's coming around. It'll obviously be more substantial than this. He's going to be like, man, what's in that hole? They're lazy, right? The easiest way is this way. Out here, we can still do the same thing with your step sticks to make them have to step over and in. That's pretty easy. That's a lot faster, easier, and more guaranteed that your trap's going to work than a primitive trap. And that's what I like about learning the trap with modern traps. We can do kind of a variation of that.
Can you go around the blockage to the hole?
Yeah, but if you block this off, he's going to go to the hole the easiest way. Animals are lazy. They're like my teenage daughter. So, the next setup is called a cubby hole. You can make this out of anything, wood, rocks, anything. I like to use a couple rotten logs. I make a V like this. Now I'll use some stuff and cover it, and I made this cubby back in there. That's going to shelter my bait. That's where I'm going to bait this. I'm going to take this leg hold. I'm going to set it out here in front, bed it. A couple step sticks. Now my bait's up under there, okay? Mr. Animal's going to do the same thing. How do I get in there? He's going to come around, oh, stick in my way. Okay, this is money. I'm telling you what, I paid my mortgage for 10 years with that. Okay, I mean, back in the day, I get $35 for a fox. I can put 10 of them up a day on a good day. So, you know, you got the tree huggers and stuff throwing paint on people and styles change. It's all, it has to do with the fashion world, really. You know, what they're into, you know, different markets, stuff like that. Ranch furs really killed the wild fur market.
What kind of fur?
Ranched.
Oh, yeah, whatever.
I can raise mink, thousands of them in a barn in a cage. They're bred so they don't have a white belly. They're all one consistent color. I keep them fed, fat, and happy. They're kept clean, they don't get rubbed up, the hides are a lot nicer. It just is what it is. They do the same thing with foxes, stuff like that. So, that's a couple easy things to do with a leg hold on dry land. Now if you remember, I told you I was going to show you how to make this kill. So, we're going to do a little more imagination using. Alright, let's pretend this dirt's the water. This fire ring is the bank. Okay? Water trapping, mink and muskrats and stuff, coons, they hunt on the edge of water. Not in the water, but the edge of water. So they're always traveling that. So now you're where you need to be. So we got our bank, we got the edge. We're going to find us a spot where out here the water is deep enough to drown whatever we're going to trap. That sounds kind of mean, drowning an animal, but it's the fastest way to do it. Okay, I mean, it's no meaner than shooting a deer and it runs off 100 yards and dies. I mean, I've watched this process firsthand, up close and personal, and it's over in 30 seconds. Okay, so don't be thinking bad of me because I'm talking about drowning animals. That's how it's done for centuries. Okay,
thinking bad.
Well, I'm used to it by now. But so we're on the edge of our water, plenty of sign, okay? What we're going to do is get our handy dandy annealed steel wire out. This is one of the staples of a trap line, modern trap line. Yeah. Use it to, you know, to secure trap rings, to stakes, all kinds of stuff. Wire bait inside a cubby if you need to, if something's stealing you. Alright, so I got some stakes here, right? What I'm going to do is identify where on the bank I see some sign. With a baited set, you don't have to be as specific, okay? So right at the edge of the water, I'm going to drive the stake. The stake at the edge of the water doesn't have to be that secure. All it's going to do is hold one end of the wire.
Steve, we're talking about the stream or what?
Water deep enough to drown the target catch. I usually like knee deep or deeper.
So there's often not a very distinct point. So it's like, do you go closer to the water? Or, you know, where would you, how
I keep it pretty close to the edge.
Pretty close to
you
the
know,
edge.
No more than 4 inches deep in the water. It's going to all depend on drop of the riverbed, things like that. So, I'm going to wade out in the water deep enough to where this animal, when he's hooked in that, can't get his nose up. I'll tell you a real bad story that'll embarrass me, but I'll tell you just to drive the point home. Secure. And generally my stakes for this are about 4 foot long. If you've ever tried to drive a stake underwater, you know it doesn't work out real well, right? So if it's tall, you can drive it, right?
Is that like a little mini screw pile or something so you can
retrieve it? I take them up another. A lot of times I'll use junk in the river where I live. You can't walk 100 yards without finding a tire in the river or a cinder block. And I'll position them. I got tires stashed down the Stillwater River that I've been using for 10 years. Right? I use them year after year after year. Or military sandbags work real good for this. Built full of rocks, use it for a weight. What I'll do is wire this out here. Okay? Good. That's not wired real good for this, but you want it wired good.
Steve, why do you use annealed wire?
Because it's soft. You'll get that here in a second. So, and you can cut it like this. Well, maybe.
You want to hit your stake?
No, I don't want to drive my stake any closer. Okay. Okay. I just take this, go like that real quick, just to hold it. Excuse me, I need a drink. That wind and this dry air takes it out of me.
Are there any things you recommend on something?
For a fishing game magazine. Oh. I mean, it's probably the best. Or Bob Gilsevic does a lot of books. Don't ask me to spell that last name, but if you notice on the end of this chain, I got this washer. When I pass this around, you'll see it. This is called a washer lock. What it'll do is allow this to slide on this wire only one direction. Okay? How that'll work is this is bent over. Our wire will come up through here and out. It'll allow it to drag down, but if the animal tries to pull it towards the bank, it'll cam over and kink the wire. I'll show you that here real quick. Yep. You want to come up through the washer like this. Try to get the kinks out of your wire.
A regular washer, you fold it over?
Fold it over and drill a hole in it. So I'm going to wire that pretty good, right? I'm just going to leave my trap sit there in the water for a second. Now I got to decide how I'm going to bait this on the bank. You can use the dirt hole, wiggle you a hole in there, I like cans of sardines. You just crack them a little bit, shove them in the hole. It's hard for them to get out, and you use it over and over until the smell's gone. Or, you know, however you want to bait it for beavers. These willow sticks with bark on them would be great, because beavers love willow bark and poplar bark. You just stick it in there. So however we're going to bait this, we're going to do it up here right on the edge of the bank. Right? We might back this somehow here. We'll decide. Now when you set these in the water, you don't have to bed them, okay? As long as it's covered. But the principles of how that has to set are still important. So we got our bank, water, our trap set. That trap cannot wiggle and move. In the water, the ground underneath is a lot softer than it is on the ground. So if that animal steps on it and it's not bedded securely, it'll move around, it might kick out. Another very important thing, the side with your dog on it needs to be towards the bank. Why that is, if we have it away, the animal's coming towards here and you got the dog pointing at him, he can step on that. When the dog flips off the jaw, it'll throw their foot out, okay? So you want that towards the bank, sitting solid. So we'll have this baited. Mr. Animal's hunting the bank, he's looking for whatever he's looking for. He's got a little, you know, something there to mess around with. If we block this off, so he's got to step out into the water a little bit. Coons and mink would rather be at the edge of the water. He's in the trap, right? Water animals like that, their first instinct to get away is in the water. So a lot of predators won't chase something in the water, right? I mean, a coyote don't go after ducks on a pond, you know what I'm saying? It's their first instinct's in the water. You notice this washer lock slides down the wire real easy? See what happens when he tries to come back up?
Not that for a long, long time.
So, that's how you can turn a leg hold trap into a killing trap. And I still think, in my opinion, that drowning an animal in a trap is more humane than holding it in a trap.
Than what?
Than holding it in a trap.
Oh, definitely.
And why this started was to stop your as a stop loss. A drowned animal doesn't work its way out of a trap, and when it's 6 foot out in the river, drowned, you know, another coon or a coyote doesn't come along to steal your catch. And that, you know, that's the main reason. People didn't start this to be nice. They started it, you know, to save their work.
Anyway, the way nature kills is to suffocate.
Yeah.
Whether it's a lion.
Crushing snakes.
Suffocating.
Yeah. Something pretty small, you probably didn't break the way this will hold. Your joints are bigger than the rest of your finger, right? Or your leg or whatever. That catches joints, okay? That's what holds that in there. It's not really the squeezing, it's the holding. So, a lot of times you can turn them loose. I turn skunks loose all the time and don't get sprayed. It's not a magic trick. They don't.
Huh?
I didn't say I didn't turn the cat loose. Later on, you can ask me about trapping cats for fun and profit. How do I let a skunk go? I carry a white sheet in my pack basket. Just a old bed sheet. I hold it like this. Okay? I walk up to the skunk. He doesn't see me, he sees a big white square. Okay. I over him, the trap, I have been sprayed by a skunk, but involved. So, and when you're dealing with that. Alright. Let me get another drink. Marshmallows a lot. That's a good point. When you're baiting traps, you can use bait animals. You don't want to catch the coons or the cats in your neighbor's barn, but you want to catch the coons. Use something that cats don't like, but coons do. Marshmallows are gold. Honey, cats don't care about marshmallows and honey or peanut butter or stuff like that, right? But, you know, I just encourage you to go for the cats. Dude, cats, where I live, cats are the scourge of the earth. There are thousands of them. They wiped out our entire quail population, and what it is every old granny at every farm where I live got 35 of them in her barn. Right? They don't feed them. They keep them as pets, don't feed them. Right? So what do? They go find them. Cats. I have something specifically against humans introducing an animal into the environment that doesn't belong there and throws off the balance. Does that make sense to you?
Well, you know they never feed them.
Yeah, we have tons of coyotes. We have that many cats. I mean, it's ridiculous. I mean, I'm not kidding.
Well, you know, in 30 years ago in Pennsylvania,
let's think of the mentality of where I live, okay?
Where are you from?
I'm from Western Ohio, farm country, the Corn Belt, okay? Farmers care about one thing, corn, soybeans, anything else, they don't give a fuck about deer population, nothing, right? A lot of places where I hunt, the deal is, if you're going to hunt here, you're going to shoot every groundhog you see, which I don't. I just say, yeah, I will, because I like groundhogs, they're kind of neat. And you're going to shoot every cat you see, right? And that's just, really, I mean, you're trying to fix a mistake that we made, that we're responsible for. I mean, that might, maybe I'm completely wrong on it, but that's just the way I think, and that's just the way I'm going. So, enough about cats.
Aren't the cats good for farmers?
What's that?
Aren't the cats good for farmers?
No, not really.
You know, a lot of cats are not good ratters. They're good terriers, but they're not ratters.
Yeah. I'll tell you a story about cats and rats. I got stories for everything. I like to tell stories because it kind of stretches my classes out and really makes it look like a hit. So, I don't know if anybody ever been in a very large production chicken house, like 6 million chickens in one barn. Everything's on conveyor belts, right? The eggs run to the front of the barn and conveyor belts run on a bigger conveyor belt running the process. Right? Rats love chicken barns. Rats love this, right? Chicken barns got tons of cats in it. I grab this cat, great big old gnarly looking tomcat. You know, you think he's a badass. I run him in there, set him down on that belt. That rat goes like this, that cat turned around and was gone. He said, hell no. Yeah. I had a 130-pound Rottweiler. You know what he thought of rats? Hell no.
And then you take a 12-pound Yorkie and he'll kill the rat.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, yeah. So anyways.
Jack Russell.
Did I pass that legal around? Yeah. Oh, yeah. What am I thinking? I started answering questions. So I'm going to pass this around, man. And I encourage you to safely, if you feel comfortable, to set this trap. Okay? If you feel comfortable doing it. Do it away. Don't be like, hey, buddy, check this out. But and we'll have a little bit of time. We can mess around with it. But I'm going to hand that around. Well, I want you to check out. Kind of, even without setting it, just kind of put the dog in the notch and kind of check out how it works, and you'll get a good understanding of how it works, okay? I keep it. Just call it non-target catch. You know, if it's dead, it's dead. I'm gonna turn it loose. It'd be wasteful. That's what I do. I'm not saying that's the right thing. You know, I don't ask them. That's the best answer I can give you. Hey, so if we can get Paul over there, get them deer. Since I can't catch a pigeon, that's too far away. If you get caught, it's like killing cat. So. Let's move on a little bit. I got a long ways to go and a short time to get there. Let's move on to the continent. Who knows that riff? Long ways to go, short time to get there. If you guys know SpongeBob, but you don't know Smokey and the Bandit, give me a break. All right, let's talk about the conifer a little bit. In a little bit of why I think this is the most versatile man-made trap made is because everything I did with that leg hold, I can do with this. And more. Okay. How we had that leg hold set in the ground. Alright, all we gotta do is set our conibear. Right? And we're gonna set it just like we had it. Yeah, where'd my hole go? You always need room under these for the trigger to travel down, right? Same principle as putting the paper on it. So I can use this just like I had that leg hold. Okay? It'll actually lift itself up and grab instead of just closing. Those bottom jaws coming around will actually reach up and get higher up on an animal's leg. So all them trap sets we just did with that leg hold, we can do with this. But we can do a lot more with this.
You boil the traps and use
anything other than canines, I don't worry about this. Too much emphasis, in my opinion, on scent. Okay? Things like coons, animals like that, a lot without bread and butter. They don't care. I mean, look, they come dig in your garbage can. You think they care about what your hands smell like? Coyotes, on the other hand, I wear full rubber waders, rubber gauntlets. You know, wash myself with baking soda. If they smell the slightest bit of human scent, they'll dig it up. Around the neck is a lot better than around the leg because he's going to die fight. Okay, rib cages. Think of how a bow can work, right? You breathe, you're squeezing, you let out. It's here. Now you go to breathe. Again, it's here. That's how these kill. Okay? With the neck or with the chest cavity. pushing on your back.
Yeah. And it's fast.
Yeah, fast. Usually, with the bigger spears, like a 220 size that you'd use for a coon, it's too dangerous. I'll tell you a story about that. That cat's getting in my garbage, okay? So what I do is take a 220 and a 5-gallon bucket. I notch the 5-gallon bucket so the springs will sit in the notches. I make that exact same set just with a 5-gallon bucket, put the bait in the back, right? Now this was from the dog warden, told me to do this. So 2:30 in the morning, I wake up and I hear all that crap. Corner of my house, this cat just got his shoulder in a corner, reaches out and grabs a hold of my leg. Okay? I go to give him the death stomp, right? I ran these two trigger bars to the bottom of my foot. Yeah, that cat got the... Anyways, there's another story.
Another cat.
What happened to the cat that you...
he didn't make it. I actually thought it was so quick and sharp, you know, and I thought it just got me, like pricked my foot. I went in the house, you know, and it's just a little red mark. Well, I went back to bed. About 2 hours later, I woke up crying. That rusty wire had poked a leader up in my foot. And it was like somebody lit my foot on fire. So I had to go to the hospital and all kinds. It was crazy. Yeah, one of these triggers, these wire triggers. Well, it was the way it was laying, when I went to stomp, I just ran through my foot. So for all the cat lovers out in this audience, there's a little bit of a revenge story for you. So, the trail set, the blind trail set. This is an awesome trap for a blind trail set. This is like a super powered snare, right? Let's use our imaginations. And we're going to imagine our trail here, right? How we're going to use this is I'm going to set that down in my trail. Okay? I'm going to kind of look at it. Now, obviously, we can't just leave it sit like that. It'd just fall over. So I'm going to kind of mark with a stake right through the center of that jaw. I'm going to drive that in. Okay? Then I'm going to take and slide that against it. I'm going to take my other stake, catching the ring on the chain through the spring. I'm going to stick that. And then, again, I'm going to fence my trail. Maybe something like that for something small, right? So, we're cruising down the trail. The path of least resistance is through, not over. Bam! Right? With these, depending on how you're going to set this, that's what them notches are for. You notice there's three notches on there, right? The closest one's going to make it lay the flattest. So you're going to use that notch when you're using it flat, like a leg hold. If you want it to set, maybe up on a log, use the widest. It'll give it a little bit of a stance. So that's why we have them notches in there. So.
Is that a modification or is that how it comes?
That's how they come from the factory. Now, the coolest thing that I ever seen caught in a conibear trap, Tony Daniel, my buddy, about a 4.5-pound largemouth. Now you're looking at me like, what? Here's how he done it. Caught a bluegill, right? Skewered it on them on these prongs. Hung this from a branch in the water. Why the heck didn't I not think of that? You know what I mean?
Did he bite it?
Bam! Oh, yeah. I mean, it was...
Bluegill.
Huh?
Bluegill.
A bluegill.
Oh, he put a bluegill on it?
Yeah. Like I said, bluegill. In the conversation, right?
You weren't looking at me. I couldn't read
your lips. Yeah, sometimes it's hard to hear you for these people who don't understand to be in the front.
I apologize. So...
Wait, did you find out that after?
No, I did not. He just did this and told me about it just, like, recently. And I was like I said, wow, why didn't I think of that?
Hey,
I
mean, is that legal out where we live?
Yeah, I don't think anything's legal in California.
No, I'm talking about Ohio. I live out east.
Generally speaking, that would not be a legal catch for fish.
Okay. This is no. Survival.
But this is survival.
Yeah, let me, I should have said something beforehand. Do not take anything I say as legal advice, okay? Because I cannot cover game laws everywhere. And really, when we're talking about self-reliance and survival, I could give a crap less about the game laws. Right? If the game warden comes and gets me, great, you know, all right. I'll pay a $100 ticket, you know, that's fine. But
that don't apply to this situation.
Well, there you go. I mean, even if they want to, I mean, $100, ride home, free meal maybe, then, man, that's good.
So. A warm cell?
Well, I mean, right? I mean,
yeah, if you're in the surrounding, yeah, I mean.
I've never found anybody on the brink of dying saying, oh, I can save myself, but I don't want to break the law. Yeah. Right? I mean, laws are made up by man. I don't really care much for them. I kind of go with the laws of nature, you know. That's the real law. I mean, so. I hand this around. I encourage you to not set this. If you want to, when we get to doing some, we're going to do some hands-on stuff here. If you want to set this, we'll come out here in the open, because this thing's got a habit of springing and flying, you know. And I really don't want to see anybody hurt. So we'll come up here. You're more than welcome to play with all the traps I got. You can do whatever.
I'm going to probably step in something thing.
Okay.
But I'll say it anyway.
Go ahead.
Probably one of the most efficient ways to get your food, as opposed to hunting. Okay, this is the way to go. And the conner bear and that rat trap are amazing.
This right here, he can feed himself, no question. Okay, no question.
Okay, so in a survival...
Go ahead.
Survival situation, I don't have that on.
Oh, and you can't use it.
One of my conny bear sets, I put a little piece of hardware cloth on it.
That's like, you know, when they're doing small birds.
Around it.
Right.
You get a dozen small birds, you get yourself a meal.
A baby rat on the leading edge, and the mama was...
Awesome. Yeah, that's killer. All right, so that's a little bit of stuff on modern traps. And I think those three traps are really good for learning traps. Because, again, we take... error of making a trap. Now we only have the human error factor of placement. And then we'll do it not my trap.
Oh, dang it. You know?
So when you're learning placement and trap skills. Ow! We have this thing here called the staff of shame. We're going to get that out.
I've got the staff of shame.
So, anyways, back to what I was talking about. We take that human error out, right? And once you get the hang of picking up on where to set traps, now you can take the factor of your mistake of making traps out, or of placing traps out, and move on to working on your mistake of making traps. That, am I saying that right? Makes sense? We're working on one problem at a time instead of both problems at once. But that makes sense.
Yep.
So after we use modern traps to learn our placement and tracking techniques, now we can move on to the cool stuff and make some primitive traps. And we'll know what the problem is then, right? Practicing trapping with primitive traps, the big problem is a lot of them kill stuff, right? I don't like to kill stuff just to practice trapping. So what I like to do is make traps that you can let stuff go from, okay? Let me get this thing. And this is somewhat of a semblance of the example of an Arapuca bird trap. It's not a bad example, but it's, you know, it's not the best. What this will do is trap an animal, or mostly birds, and I have caught squirrels in them, and you can let them go. You can trap the same blue jay like 15 times in a row because that's just the way they act, and it's great fun. So, now, I hope you all can see and understand and come up a little bit and look at how these are put together. Because I'm going to give you a little bit of a hint of what's going to go on here after a little bit. You're going to want to know how to make a couple of these traps, okay? We'll get to that in a little bit. So as you can see, this trap is basically just a cage stacked up and held together with string. Has a lot of people here had some experience with these?
Mm-hmm.
Do you know what I'm talking about? I got this, I tried to set this up kind of like a cooking show here so where I can just pull things out of the oven that are done. The first thing we got to do is start the base of this, okay? For me, I want the bottom base to be kind of a substantial set of sticks, flat, so when it comes down on the ground, it lays flat, the rails will lay flat. What I'll do is just lay these out. And I'll kind of measure.
What kind of cord are you using?
This is just tarred bank line. Okay, nylon line with tar on it. And I'll just kind of measure this out. So I need two pieces about like that. Take one of my sticks, right? I'm gonna try to hold my hands up so everybody can see. Everybody know how to tie a clove hitch?
No.
Make a loop, 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 put it behind itself. Like that.
Does that have a name, Steve?
Clove hitch. Then I'm gonna tighten that down and I'm gonna back it up with just one overhand knot. I'm going to do that on both sides. Some people do this a little different. They'll string them straight across in a rectangle and then twist them, and I can never get the spacing of that right. So this is just the way I do it.
So this is not the official Paul Campbell method. We're not saying.
No, I'm no Paul Campbell, just to go on record. So.
Thank God.
Okay, so I'm going to lay this out here at my spacing.
Paul. I hear that a remark.
He's taking a nap.
He got a nap. He's talking to himself.
He said he thought he wasn't much of a nerd, so he walked away. Just joking.
All right, so I'm going to tie these now in an X across this frame. I'm going to tie a clove hitch in it. Back it up with a square knot, or an overhand knot, I'm sorry. We'll lay that up. We'll do the same thing over here. Now for me personally, I don't want very much slack in this at all when I start out.
Therefore, nor should we, right?
Well, some people do it a little different and it comes out, but this is just the way it works for me. When it comes to building traps, there's no right or wrong way. If it works, it's right. Okay?
Same with fire making.
So what we're going to come out with is this. Everybody see that? It's just an X with two sticks on the end of it. We're going to lay that down. And to start this, basically, to get this log cabin shape, all we got to do is just start stacking these up. You'll basically start sliding them in like this, pushing them to the outside, on and on and on. Back and forth, back and forth. And what we're going to come up with at the end of that is this. Okay, our X is still there. That's the tension holding it down. I took and trimmed this up. If it's clean, it'll work better. Form follows function and function follows form. Okay, on this. If it looks like a soup sandwich, it's going to operate like one. That makes sense? So, you tell this end is just one line of string going over. Okay, you see that? It'll work just like that. What I like to do is go through and lash it so it's one piece. And I find that more, as Paul Campbell would say, aesthetically appealing. And he won't throw it over the hill on you that way. So, I need to set this somewhere. Man, I hope you guys can see this, the way I do this. But I gotta set this up. Okay, I got this edge here, right? And I wanna secure that. And I also wanna pull all this tight. So what I'm gonna do is another clove hitch. I use the clove hitch a lot because I only know a handful of knots. So, and I'm gonna tie that on the bottom. Okay? There. You guys see what I'm doing here? Tie that on the bottom. So, people over here. No, sir. I'm lashing the corners. So I'm gonna go under that one, okay? I'm gonna pull it tight. Wrap it. I'm gonna come to the other side. Pull it tight. Wrap it.
You want somebody to hold that while you do it?
Nah, I'm good. You see how this is pulling these sticks out? And pulling it tight. Then I'm going to wrap it and lock it. I'm going to pull it tight. Wrap it. Pull it tight. Wrap it. I'm not sure if this is,
you know. Going around each one up to the top.
Yeah. I'm just lashing them to pull this corner tight. And you see how that pulls your corners out and gives you a more vertical wall. Gives you more room in the trap.
Look how they're lining up.
Okay. You wrap that and you come to this one, pull it back. Okay. We're going to do that. Now see how this string's pulling tight and all these sticks are starting to walk out. This is why I'm lashing this. So I can come up under this one now, pull it over. When I wrap it, it locks. I can come to this one, pull it over, wrap it, it locks. Okay? I'm gonna come all the way up like that. Then up here, I just kind of come down to the next one and do whatever you feel like to tie this off. There's really no right or wrong ways. If it works, it's right. Okay. I'm going to cut this off. I'm going to take, come around here. Maybe. Just wrap it up a couple times. And I just finish it off with a couple overhand knots. We'll do that a couple times with an overhand knot. So basically now I got this, all the corners lashed, right? And that makes this just so much stronger. And then what it, lashing these, what I find is it brings these walls more vertical and it gives you more room in the trap. Back here there's some quails and they're pretty big. So a little more room in that trap is what we want. Then the top, you notice it's open, we can't have that. So what we're going to do is just start sliding some pieces in here and working it across as we go. And what that's going to come out like, through the magic of television, is this. Okay? So basically we got a cage, or a basket, but mainly a cage. So we need to put a trigger on this, right? Okay. Here's one of the reasons why keeping this neat is important, is the way this is going to set. I'm going to choose whichever side of my trap is nice and even, the points, because this is where it's going to pivot. So if that's kind of jacked up, this thing's not going to set right, okay? And I'm just going to tie a piece of bank line in a V from corner to corner, long enough to come just past the front, okay? Now we need to make a trigger for this. I need a drink. See now that string was on there, everybody? It's kind of hard to see bank line from a ways away. What I need to judge to make the height of this trigger, if this is sitting flat on the ground, okay, I'm going to make the front edge up in the air. I need to decide what my main target catch is to decide what height this is going to be up off the ground. And why I want that is because of the angle. The farther this gets up in the air, lifted up off the ground, the slower the trap is. So the lower we can keep that angle, the less distance it has to close. Make sense? Okay. What we're going to make for this is called a scarf joint trigger. And basically, if I had a whiteboard, I'd draw it. It's going to look like two chairs that sit on each other. Really easy to make. Okay. Took a stick. I'm going to make a cut down from the bottom, or down from the top halfway. We'll come over about a half an inch or so and make a cut up from the bottom halfway. And what that's going to do, when you break it, it's going to make two pieces that look like a chair. Okay? Everybody see that? Looks like a chair. And that's going to sit on top of each other. So, the first thing we need to do is clean this joint up just a little bit.
Like a throne. More like a throne at Dirttime.
You're throne at Dirttime?
I really have throne. I'm the king on my
high back chair.
High back chair, there you go.
Okay. So them sit together pretty good. Like that, when you put it back together. Now, I leave this long when I start this trigger, so I got something to hold on to. I cut it to length last. That's just my way of doing it. You can do it however you want. So what I like to do, just hold my trap up and kind of decide the height I want, kind of eyeball it, and we're there about that little knot, and I'll just cut that off. Alright, so I got that cut off, and these are going to sit together like that. So, we have this V string here, okay? I'm going to take half my trigger piece, I'm going to put it in this V string, and I'm just going to wrap that a couple times and kind of judge where that hits the trap. I can adjust this trigger in and out by how many times it's wrapped. See how I got that bag in that string there? If you can see it, that string needs to be tight, so when something bumps it, it instantly pulls that scarf joint apart. You watch how that rolls out. I'm going to put just one more wrap in there. Okay. on any of these triggers, if it's hard to get set, you probably got it right. Because that means it's easy to go off, right? I like a hair trigger. So this one, see how that rolled out real quick? This trap right here, I tried to make pretty nice. It took me about 15 minutes of construction time. So if I'm sitting around my camp, I could make one of them in the evening pretty easy. You know, I mean, it's not that involved. It's pretty durable. You can move it around. Live meat never spoils. So if you catch something alive and you can keep it alive, we can make one just like this and make it a cage. We can catch birds and store them. We don't have to smoke meat, salt meat, however we're going to preserve it. Or if it's something we don't want, we can let it go. So I'll hand that trigger around so everybody can see kind of how it goes together.
Bird in captivity like that. Yeah.
All right, where am I going? Oh, okay. One thing I hardly ever talk about is fishing.
A lot of people fish. A lot of
the old society, you know, like Native Americans. I study a lot of Eastern woodlands, Native Americans, big 18th century stuff. During Queen Anne's War, which is like one of the thousand wars England fought with France in the 18th century. A set of colonial rangers went up the Connecticut River and ambushed a set of Mohegan natives working on the bank. They were putting up fish for the winter. In the first-hand account, there was 40 natives working this fishing operation. Okay? They killed all the natives. They took away 9 tons of dried fish. And destroyed the majority. If I take 9 tons of dry fish and destroy the majority, how much fish do you think they had? That should tell you the importance of fishing. It's so easy to dry fish out and preserve it, and it's a lot easier to catch. They're a captive audience. You go down here to this pool, where are they going? You know where they're at, right? They're so hungry. Anton was catching them on a gold hook. Just a gold metal hook. That is a lot easier than hunting. That's a lot easier than building traps. They're, you know where they're going to be, right? So, what if we don't have fishing equipment? Lines and hooks and all that. What I want to do for our hands-on part here is show you how to make a hook. Two different kinds of, well, one would be considered a gourd, one would be considered a hook. In this bag, I have honey locust thorns. Oh, you guys have honey locust trees out here?
We have no black locusts.
Black thorns. No. We've got a
bright locust. Oh, do we really?
Okay. Where I'm from, honey locust thorns get about the size of pencils. They go through truck tires, all kinds of stuff. If you get the small ones, these things are great for so many things. You can make needles out of these. You can make small bird points for arrows out of these. Fish hooks. Just multiple, anything you need something sharp for. Okay? Now, okay. Let me set this. So, there's basically two types of primitive hooks that I use. One is a hook, which is a V-shaped hook. The other would be just what's called a gorge. And I'll talk about the gorge a little bit first. Since it's going to be hard to see this little thing in my hand, I got my demo thorn. You know, if you come across thorns like this, I'd stay away from them trees. Basically, what a gorge is going to be is just a straight piece, sharp on both ends. The idea is the fish will swallow it, it'll get in his gut, and then he can't get it back out. Okay? But there's a specific way that this works the best. My thorn's only sharp on one end, so I'm going to sharpen the other end, okay? That's my thorn. Watch me.
Yeah.
That was for two.
Blade's going that way.
Oh.
had to rag on dude a little bit. Okay, so I'm going to sharpen the other end of that thorn. Now, I want to hook my line on here, but I don't want to hook it in the middle. I want to hook it just a little off center towards the end that I sharpened, okay?
Great with the burden.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. I'm gonna tie this on here. Towards the end I sharpened, just a little off center, okay? Maybe I am. Okay, so I got my fishing line, my gigantic gorge. What I'm going to do when I bait this is I'm going to take the long end and point it up with my natural tip on it, okay? I'll take this and shove it down through my bait. So my bait's encasing this. When the fish swallows this, it'll go down his throat. Now notice the top end is longer and it has the razor sharp natural point on it. What that's going to do when he tries to pull off of it is toggle over. That natural point, I mean, when you get to working with these thorns, somebody's going to poke themselves, I promise you. That'll work over and basically it won't come back out of their gut. That's basically the easiest one to make, but I think it's kind of hit or miss when they work. I've never had a big amount of success with it. What I do like best is to make an actual hook. Here's an example of a thorn hook, and I'll hand this around. Basically, what you do is take a thorn and you cut it at an angle, glue it, and you'll wrap it up with some plant fibers or something, and then tie it onto a string. Now this angle in here is pretty important. If you have this angle too obtuse, it won't go down your throat. These hooks, you cannot wait as soon as they bite it and hook them. You know, hook them through the lip, they just don't work that way. You gotta let it go down their gut. And that's a real hard learning curve for a lot of people because they fish with modern fishing equipment. As soon as that fish bites, they want to hook it. You gotta let them take it. It takes a little bit of patience, but you gotta get this angle pretty acute. You want it small. Small hooks catch a lot of fish. Big hooks catch big fish. Okay, I'd rather catch a lot of fish than one big fish. That's just, there's more small fish. Okay? So we're gonna go over the construction of making a fish hook. I have enough stuff for everybody to make a fish hook. Now, some people might think I don't want to make a fish hook. But what I'm going to tell you after we make fish hooks will make you want to make a fish hook, if that makes sense. I always put on a contest. Right? This will play an important role. So hand that around so you guys can get an idea.
This year they don't throw a fish in your bunk at 3 in the morning.
Yeah.
Alright. That wasn't a good reaction.
So, I got a couple more demo thorns here. This is my thorn, right? Giant size.
Want the cutter?
That's the target. That's the
cutter. Yeah. Good. So, how I want to get that angle, I want to use my imagination. I want to look at this thorn and kind of visualize that angle, right? So to get that angle, I need half of this. You want to divide that angle in half, and that's how I want to cut it. about like that. Okay? That way I just cut this thorn. Everybody make sense? I'll flip that upside down. There's my hook. Okay? If you look at some of these thorns, they'll have a secondary thorn sticking off of them. And you'll think, because this thorn's sticking off like this, that you can just flip it this way and make a hook. It don't work that way. I'll explain to you why. The fat end of the thorn is always going to be towards the tree, right? There's no eyes in these. So when we tie these to our line, we want the fat end up. So when we tie it down here, this end's fatter than where it's tied and won't slip through the string. Okay? That's the reason we do it that way. The reason I like to use thorns instead of carving something, a thorn, the way the grain of a thorn grows, a thorn grows point out, right? So the grain all comes together at the point. If you carve a point on that sharp end, you got one grain, right, sticking up. It's pretty weak. If I got all that coming together, that point's really strong. Carved hooks will work, bone hooks will work, shell hooks will work. But I like to use thorns, and that's the reason why. So, what we're going to do is use some of our pine resin. Through the magic of television, here I go. I got my lighter. It's windy out here. I got some pine resin on my piece, okay? I just dipped it in my little container of pine resin. Everybody use pine resin glue? The epoxy of the woods?
Of course.
Great stuff. Alright, if I can do this without... So, I got that hot. I'm going to glue that together. I'm going to kind of work at down. So, that's glued. Okay. One thing we got to watch out about using this glue is we're going to try to keep from making bulk down here at this point. If we start using too much material to connect this, this will start turning kind of bulbous and it'll be... You know, it just won't work. So it'll start getting fat because we're going to have to add something to back this up. Because this is not going to hold together. So, generally I'll use something like just a couple plant fibers. I'll use just a couple plant fibers to wrap this up. But since we're cheating anyways, we're going to use some bank line. And when we go to make these, what we can do is one piece of this bank line will work for three people. Okay?
How big a piece you cutting for three people?
Oh, about that
two
long.
2.5 feet, 3 feet.
What we're going to do is make a liter first. Okay? Then we're going to take... When we're making the small ones, right, we're just going to take about 4 inches and strip this way down. We're going to take and get this untwisted. This bank line's tarred, so sometimes it's kind of hard to get it to come apart. Everybody's going to have a piece of line like this. It's 1/3 of a piece of bank line. Bank line's like a 120-pound test. Split it down into thirds. I'm not smart enough to know how better to explain that. But when you're making yours, you're going to want to cut 4 inches off of that. If you see these I'm handing around, I took these thirds, and I just take strip a couple hairs off of. Right? Fiber's going. For my big demo, I'm going to use this piece. What I'm going to do, if you got a cigarette lighter or whatever you want to use, kind of use your fingers and hold this together. We're going to set that string in the glue while it's hot. Okay? So we got that set. Then down here at the bottom of this, we're going to wrap it a couple times around that point. Like that. Then we're going to come inside the belly of our hook and do a figure eight. And depending on how much bulk you're building up, you can do that to your action. The beauty of bank line is it's got tar on it. So when I set my reinforcement into this glue, it's actually going to melt down a little bit. So, then I can touch that up while it's still hot. And basically now I have that reinforced. Okay? So, tying this on, we got the fat end of our thorn up here. It's tapered up, right? There's no eye in it. A lot of you guys know how to do this if you ever paracord wrapped a knife handle. What you're going to do is fold a bite, which is just bend the line over. Okay? You're going to lay that on the shank of your hook. Do a couple wraps down, back towards that loop. Go through that loop. Then you're going to take your working end, tighten that down. Okay? So basically that'll cinch itself down. And now since this is fatter than here, it don't want to pull off. Now there's a certain way you got to tie this on. It needs to be in the belly of the hook, not the back. See how this hangs kind of point up? When this hooks, it'll stay that way. If we hook it in the back like this and it hooks, it wants to roll over. So you want it in the belly of the hook. Does that make sense? Everybody backing me, you think we can do this? Make some hooks? Okay. One other thing we're going to work on a little bit, if you so choose, is another very, very simple, the easiest trap in the stinking world to make, in my opinion. That's called a promontory point deadfall. A guy was going to be here until he got sick, that rediscovered, reinvented, I guess you would call this trap, from, like, found artifacts. Basically, this, the way I build this required one cut, and you want to do it with a running tool. It works the best with, like, a stupid tool. You see how I'm doing this, dude?
Yeah.
The wood is in the bench is in between me and the knife. I'm just saying. So I made a cut halfway through this stick, halfway like we did the scarf joint, right? And it's just at a little bit of an angle. Now some people do this different. They make like two out of one stick. I'm not good enough to do that. So what you want to do is take that and break it. Okay? So I got this stick and this. I'm going to take...
So you said you cut it halfway through?
I cut it halfway through and just snap it. You see how this will peel out?
Yeah.
I just take this
good way to make your scarf joint, quasi-scarf joint.
Knock that out, right? So now we got a point. So what's going to happen...
It's not a scarf joint.
I said quasi.
I'm going to have my deadfall weight, okay? All this does is set right there. Just like, kind of like our scarf joint did sit. Perfect point. Now I got this little point sticking out here, right? That's where I'm going to bait this. I'm just going to stick something on there or glue a seed to it or whatever. And I'm going to stick that on my deadfall. Okay, so I got that stick, just a stick sitting on a stick. I got my bait in that notch. They come up, fiddle with that bait, it folds and falls. Now there's a way to do that, you make two of them at once.
One and a half.
I don't know how to do that. This is the way I do it, it's quick and easy, one cut, snap.
You didn't redo the article and wrote it this way?
No.
Do you have copies to autograph to?
Yeah, I'll
with your good hand.
Step that up again.
Well, hold on. So I got this stick.
Don't let him cut it though.
I'm not gonna cut anything. I don't need to cut it. No, I want him to set that up again.
Okay.
Are you gonna show your variation treadle mechanism, Steve?
No.
When you set that up, you guys should bait it first.
Yeah.
Then if you take a little skinny twig and push down in between, mm-hmm. and have bait on those, it'll come out that far. It's got one on the top and two on the sides.
Okay.
And it will flip it the same way.
There you go. Another hint. So, now that I've been up here babbling and rambling for an hour and a half, this being dirt time, let's make something, right? So what I got is enough blank sticks cut for everybody to make their own promontory point deadfall. Here's how you make it. That's all the instruction you need. And everybody to make their own thorn hook. Okay? Before we start on this, I want to tell you why you really might want to do this. Every time I do a class, I put on a little bit of a contest, okay? Last year, I did a little trapping contest. I gave away a custom Jeff White Nesmik style skinner. Pretty nice knife. No, I mean, it's not top end, but a nice knife, and it was fun. It inspires competition. It gets people doing it, right? This year, I'm going to do the same thing. I'm changing the rules. You cannot use a trap that's man-made. You got to make it yourself. You can use man-made cordage.
Oh, man.
You can use man-made cordage in your trap. Here's the rule. Nothing man-made other than your cordage, fur, feathers, or fins. Don't bring me a handful of grasshoppers and tell me you want. Okay? Mr. Jason Gustafson from Lester River Bushcraft is providing the prize this year. I'll let him tell you what the prize is, because to me it's just that big of a prize. Jason?
I build a few knives myself, so whoever wins, there's going to be a couple stipulations, just because I only use A2 steel, and that's because I know the heat treat on it, and you're going to get the pick, we're going to design. Whoever wins, we're going to sit down, we're going to draw up what you want, and I'll build it, within reason, no Conan swords or pommel plates. But we'll figure something out, up to a certain length, a belt type knife or a neck knife, but we'll sit down, draw it up, and when I get back to Duluth, I'll build it and I'll mail it to you.
Ooh.
So whoever wins,
good luck. Not only do you get a custom knife made by Jason at Lester River Bushcraft, you get your custom knife.
Yeah.
Right.
And what you want.
You get one built by a great knife maker.
A great knife maker, it'll be the only one in existence. And when you got it, you say, hey, check out my new knife. Guess how high I won that. So.
Do we have to eat it?
Yeah. If we kill it, we're eating it.
Hell yeah.
If you bring it to me alive, well, I don't care. Let it go, you know. That's the rules. Fur, feathers, or fins. Right?
Can we bring you to it?
What's that? Yeah.
Now, here's the reason I kind of went over this Arapuca bird trap. I don't want to force anybody to... If they want to participate, I don't want to force you to break the law to participate, okay? So if you can make something simple and catch something alive, all the better, right? Or a fish. You can hook a fish. That's why we're making hooks. Okay? You can hook a fish, bring it to me alive, throw it back in the creek. No harm, no foul. You got a knife.
For those of you that don't have a fishing license for California, make sure you have someone 15 years or younger next to you.
Yes, they're fishing.
What if they're required to be with somebody with a
If there's a dispute,
first one to you.
Yeah. If there's a dispute, we'll figure that out.
Yeah. So, what if I catch a hairy man with just what nature gave me?
Previously
in captivity,
don't
count. I'm sorry. there's the river's right back here. It's all for us. Okay. So, whoever wants to protect. It's the first person to bring me fur, fins, or feathers.
It's not real complicated.
Okay. It's got to be made here.
It has to be made simple.
Out of natural materials, except your cordage. It's just going to take too long if somebody wants to make a bird trap to make all that cordage. So we're going to let a little slip there.
What if we make an explosive out of the natural material?
I'll be impressed. So, anyway.
That must have been back. Yeah, of course it was.
Hey, you know I was over there snooping.
All right, what I got is a bag of thorns. I got plenty of thorns. Right? We're gonna. You can help. We'll hand them out. Whoever wants to make.